The title of my presentation today is Virtual Experiments in Food Processing. And this was actually, this study or this work was before the last decade. We started with Dr. Paul Singh. When I was doing my postdoc with him in UC Davis some years ago, we decided to, we came up with this idea to form or to make some virtual experiments in food processing area. And this idea came from the fact that we were both, I was in the food engineering area and I was working with him at that time in the biological engineering discipline. And all our studies were based on mathematical modeling of food processing operations. So then we realized that during the time, everybody started having computers. So computers became very, very easy to obtain at that time after 2000. So in the meantime, in the engineering discipline, everybody started the new technologies and teaching tools to educate the students, because you know, there was an increasing challenge in the outside world. So we were trying to overcome these challenges with the education. So for this purpose, we decided to make these virtual experiments to be used in the food process engineering or food processing area. These are our websites for Dr. Paul Singh and for myself, and there are some additional information about all these educational tools in these websites you can find. First of all, I would like to start about the experimental methodology in teaching. As we know that in all the engineering disciplines, we have hands-on lab experiments, because we think that and we know that they are the most effective tools in teaching new concepts and testing novel hypotheses in the engineering or in the education, especially in the engineering education. For the case of food and bioprocess engineering, food and bioprocess engineering education involves the application of engineering disciplines to food and agricultural commodities, and our objective is always to produce safe and high quality products. Therefore, hands-on lab experiments are regarded to be as excellent teaching tools to educate our students with the increasing challenges. And how we do this in the experiments or in the lab? First of all, we cluster the students in the groups, and they spend a certain time around the workbench doing the experiment or watching the experiment. First of all, in this kind of approach that have been followed for all the years since engineering education started, there is a limited time. Especially when we have more than several students in a group, they receive an uneven exposure time in the experiment. And in addition, besides this case, it is difficult to design an experiment to examine the effect of various variables on the outcome. That's impossible to do that. And all these lead us to demonstrate only one set of processing condition for a given process and in this given amount of time allocated for this lab or for this class. So this is a traditional approach we are following, and apparently we are not achieving the functional understanding of the effect of various input variables on the process performance. Our personal observations, also my personal observation teaching these kind of classes, indicate that there are just few active learners in these groups. They actually perform the required tasks in a typical lab exercise. And what happened to the rest? The rest, some of them just observe what's happening in the experiment, or they just observe the other friends or other students who are doing actually active in the experiments, and some others, and mostly, and this number is sometimes quite large, they just daydream. They just watch, or they don't even think about what's going on in the experiment. In addition to all these disadvantages, the universities cannot afford to maintain up-to-date labs or up-to-date instruments with the latest condition. It's impossible to have all the cases to follow or to perform all the experiments. especially for the case of food engineering. Recently, I changed my affiliation from Mersin University to Ankara University. And in our Mersin University, canning experiment was one famous experiment that we were doing in our heat transfer and unit operation, our food processing classes. But in Ankara, we cannot do that because we don't have that equipment or retort and those kind of equipment in our lab. So that's where our virtual experiments come into the picture that I will show in a minute with some demonstration. Based on all this, our objective was, when we started this project at that time, first of all, to develop the virtual labs for various food processing operations. That was the first objective. And with this way, we focused to improve the understanding of food processing principles. And also, of course, the more important case was to reduce the cost and time required for lab experiments. The second and the third one I told right now was the secondary objective, but the first objective was to develop the virtual labs to be really used by citizens in front of their computers. So how we did that? First of all, we as I said at the beginning of my talk, we were doing a lot of mathematical modeling studies with the support of different food processing operations, including almost like freezing, thawing, frying, or grilling, or canning. Almost every process, we had developed our own mathematical modeling codes. So we decided to use that, and we also decided to make a more user-friendly case. So that's why we created these labs, or we use these numerical simulation codes in Microsoft Visual Basic. At that time, it was the programming language was Microsoft Visual Basic. Now it has changed to Microsoft Visual Net or Visual Basic Net. So we used this language at that time, and the numerical codes were accompanied by some ActiveX programs for the graph abilities, visualization, and spreadsheet abilities. I will demonstrate all these in a minute. And then we also used animated picture technologies to give the taste of an hands-on, actual hands-on lab experiment when the students were doing this virtual experiment in front of their screen or in their computer. So the use of virtual labs involved with this way to the users, the students, to interact by setting operation parameters, observe the changes in the experiment or in the process, and of course, to record the data for the further analysis. And these virtual labs were used in conjunction with this way. They were also used in conjunction with lecture and lab experiments. So if we make a small, short comparison between a traditional lab exercise and a virtual lab, in a lab exercise, hands-on lab exercise in a traditional way, students run an actual process using a limited number of operating conditions and then analyze the data. That's what we do for the years. In a virtual lab, however, in addition to the traditional lab, students, first of all, might generate their own set of additional data because the virtual lab just continues for several minutes or several seconds now with the fast computers. Then the students might understand how the industrial systems work using our animation technologies. The output from the simulations might be analyzed as if it were real actual data, like obtained from a hands-on lab experiment. And students can easily determine the effects of operating conditions on the results because they can do several things in a short amount of time. So with this way, we have developed 27 experiments, and these experiments were in the area of fluid flow, heat transfer fundamentals, mass transfer operations, food processing operations, and food storage and transport. So in every experiment, we followed a certain way, so the students will be familiar for every way. So we had a navigation bar that we used in each experiment. This navigation bar, as you can see in the screen, included different modules, submodules. So each of these submodules had something about the experiment, and this navigation bar was the same for every experiment. So when you use one experiment, or when you follow a certain the rules of one experiment, it was easy to follow up all with all the rest. So we have the overview part first of all, and now I will just tell you what are these four one by one in a short way. So in the overview part, overview of a lab exercise, we have the overview of the lab exercise where the steps required to take sequentially to complete the virtual experiment described in this in that case. Then in the second case, we have these industrial systems or industrial applications, which is relevant to each exercise. We have this submodule. Industrial applications to relevant to each lab exercise with animated illustrations to help students obtain a comprehensive understanding of engineering and operating principles behind the application were presented in this submodule. Then we have the procedure case where we have the photographs and diagrams describing how an experiment is really conducted in a hands-on lab exercise. Now I am showing some examples from a canning experiment that I will also demonstrate a real experiment or real virtual experiment in a second. And following that, we have the theory or theoretical considerations to present the concept and the laws and equations governing the physical phenomena in each exercise. And then we have the virtual experiment, or we have the operator panels for users to select the operating conditions. This operator's panel came from an idea that a user might select the operating variables as a core part of the virtual experiment, and this interacts the user with the exercise in an easy way. And it is also similar that in a real case or real industrial or real hands-on lab experiments case, how a person or however student will select the operating conditions for the given case. For example, in this picture, we have the control panel for the canning experiment, where you can change the retort temperature, cooling temperature, heating time, initial temperature, or you can also change, you have the ability to change the can size. These are the three common cans that which are used in the canning industry, or you can actually come up with your own can size that and then you can do the experiment for each different condition or for each different can, and then you can see the results and you can compare the results also in that way. Then we have this virtual experiment page that where the results are being presented in spreadsheets and in similar to like how an operator will obtain the results from a data acquisition system, for example, or an instrument in a real case scenario. And we have these colorful observations, these illustrations where the users might, or where the students might observe the changes occurring during the process. This is the page. Then we have this, data analysis submodule where we are describing how to analyze the results using the results of the experiment. We have the discussion questions. There are just some typical questions for each exercise, but anybody or any lecturer or instructor might come up with their own questions. Then we have this submodule for the online resources where we are showing some links to industry sites for more information can be obtained. And we are also giving the references to consult for writing a short for the report of the experiment. We have this my journal case that you can take your notes. It is opening the notepad page for you. And now these are the basic things that we have in an experiment. So all these submodules were designed in a way that the impact of visualization and simulation can be maximized by their interactivity with the user, by their practicality to use, and by their interconnectivity through the navigation bar. With this way, in each exercise, computation results through simulations running in the background might be observed or visualized through the extensive graph and spreadsheet animation and animation abilities. Now, I would like to show you the demonstration of some experiments that I kept talking about. Now I will open a canning experiment. This is one of my favorite, since canning is still holds a very significant amount of thermal processing area in food industry. Now we have this overview case, as I showed, told you before, where we are explaining a certain background on the experiment. We are defining the objective and what we are telling the, showing the students what they will learn using this experiment. Then we have these industrial systems with the animation abilities. For example, here we are showing how an retort or a steam retort is working. The steam is introduced into the retort from the steam spargers. And these are the small cans located in the retort. And we have here the atmospheric retort, or here we have this rotating retort where the cans are being rotated. This is the animation or how the real retort is really working. That's what we show. And we have this other one, the pressure retort. The entire vessel is filled with steam at high pressure and cans enter and exit the retort in a continuous manner. This is how it works. And these are the, some cross-sectional view of different retort systems. Now, after that, we have procedures. As I told you, we are explaining how a real hands-on experiment was really being conducted. So these are some photographs and pictures of a like thermocouple, how we install a thermocouple in a can that we are showing here. And this is the thermocouple, which is which was connected with nut and bolt to the can top. And this is like the can with the thermocouple. And this is the retort that at that time we had in our facilities, the rotating retort. So in the theory, we are explaining how the data can be analyzed. And then we have the virtual experiment. As I told you, you can easily choose one of the can sizes based on your objective. You can change the retort temperature or cooling temperature or heating time or initial temperature in any way you want. Then when you say start the experiment, it will start and it will show you the temperature change in the center, in the corner of the can, and somewhere between center and corner. You can always start and stop, as you can show. And here we are showing the temperature distribution from cold to hot in the cross-section, vertical cross-section of the can. So with this way, we have completed one set of experiments. We can always go back to the operator panels. We can change it. We can again do another experiment. Now this is for other can size. These are the temperature changes inside the can again. And then when we say with data in the spreadsheet, these are our, this is our result for the second experiment, for example. And you can easily save this in an Excel format. And you can then later on, you can use this for your analysis. So this is one set of the experiment that for canning. And after that, as I told you, we have the data analysis. We are explaining how we are analyzing the data by illustration in an illustrative point. And we have the discussion questions, we have online resources. You can easily go back to these websites to get more information about the canning. And we are giving some references that you can read more, or we are directing or asking the students to make a certain research on this. In the this here, we have the notepad. You can actually take notes about your experiment like this, and you can save this later on. It's like your notebook in the real hands-on experiment case. And then basically, yeah, that's about it. So these are the data for the second one also. So this is one experiment for the canning. I would like, since we have said we have some time, I will show you another one. This is a modified atmosphere packaging example. Yeah. Okay, here we are showing some, giving some information about the modified atmosphere packaging of fruits and vegetable. We have the procedures, how a lab experiment is really conducted. Like we have the GC to determine the gas concentration in the package at periodic intervals. We have the certain procedures here defining. We have the theory here, saying that the rate of reaction is described by a Michaelis Menten type model. And then we have the, here we have the data analysis, we are explaining it. And then in the virtual experiment, we have blueberry, and we have two types of package film, which are produced from different companies like Oreca and Salam Plus. We have two temperatures, and you can choose easily the amount of the product here. Like let's say we are starting with 250 gram with clean pass at 15 degrees C. When we start the experiment, we are seeing the carbon dioxide and oxygen concentration change in the package. And then we can do another experiment to see the effect of the temperature, and we can see that how the gas concentrations are becoming equal in a shorter time. We can also see how the different package film are affecting. And then when we say that all the results of the experiments are given here, and these are the oxygen and carbon dioxide concentrations obtained at certain intervals. And imagine that if you really want to do this experiment really in the lab, for example, for these conditions, it will take probably around 40 hours to get a certain amount of data. But in the lab, in this virtual experiment, you can do it in a shorter amount of time, and you can easily see the effect of temperature and the effect of different package films. This was another experiment that we did to show the effect for the food processing or food packaging case. Now I'm going back to my presentation after demonstrating these experiments. These virtual experiments over the years have been routinely used in different universities for the past decade, including our universities, UC Davis, Mersin, and Ankara University. And I will just show you a small list of the universities that have introduced new courses and lab exercises using the virtual experiments described in this webinar. UC Davis, Ankara, and Mersin universities were like our universities, so we have been constantly using these experiments. Then Ohio State, University of Illinois, Oregon State, Purdue, Cal State, and Pomona, University of Newfoundland, Canada, Iowa State universities use these experiments. And the instructors from over 30 countries have acquired our software from us to enhance their teaching. So if I conclude my presentation with our, first of all, our personal, unfortunately, I have to admit that we didn't do any pedagogic study on this, but our personal observations revealed that the virtual labs let the students get engaged more in the hands-on lab experiments after completing these virtual labs accompanied with the hands-on lab experiment. They encourage the students to explore the what-if scenarios. They eliminated the obstructive effect of not having the appropriate equipment to conduct various experiments, and they allowed students to develop higher level cognitive skills to analyze and evaluate processing parameters.